Stravinsky's Le Sacre du Printemps, The Rite of Spring. It was a work that Boulez became especially famous and acclaimed for in the early years of his international conducting career during the 1960s. At that time, this music, and very especially its very highly complex changes of rhythmic meters, still was very problematic for many orchestras and also for many conductors. And players were both alarmed but also inspired by Boulez's absolute insistence on total accuracy and observance of all the composer's markings. And they were galvanized by his technical mastery actually conducting the score. And all these elements were to be the hallmarks of his conducting right through his career.
You know, the other day the articulation was not enough, and then too much. Now we must find really the right way. Un, ya, ta, 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 long each time. But one must perceive the rhythm between in the group, you know. And that now that's confused, all right?
When the rhythm is not right, it shocks me. As I mean, really, I cannot stand it. And I learned rhythm in this score, I must say. Not at first in a funny way, not listening to it, so I mean with a performance in the orchestra, but playing it piano four hands. You know, there is a reduction for piano four hands because then so there was no recording in 1913, and then the rehearsals were always done by piano four hands. And so therefore, with some students, who were students in the same time as I was, we performed this piece quite a lot. So that was, you know, a work where I learned rhythm. You know, that's a thing which I immediately catch, the rhythmical. I don't like, you know, a kind of performance which is just virtuosity. Because virtuosity, yes, you can do, and you can do that quick, but there is no weight. There is not the heavy aspect of the danse sacrale, for instance, the last dance. I say always, you know, just give me more sound because it should be heavy. And if the rhythm is just superficial, then it does not make any impression. It has no consequence.
I think it's fair to say that in his day, Pierre Boulez had a major international influence in establishing the highest possible standards of playing this music. And not just technically, but also artistically. The London Symphony Orchestra's former longtime principal clarinet, Andrew Marriner, bears this out.
He used to gently terrorize. Certainly I remember the Rite of Spring with the National Youth Orchestra of Great Britain. The approach was very unforgiving in the nicest possible way. It was really impossible for him to accept that even 11, 12, 13-year-olds couldn't play 11 even notes and they were splitting them up into groups. And he said, no, you must be 1, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 9, 8, 10, 11. Exactly even like that, you see. And this would go on for hour after hour.
the chosen one, the sacrificial victim, dances herself to death, and the curtain comes down on Stravinsky's ballet, Le Sacre du Printemps, the Rite of Spring. And it wasn't only Boulez's technical and musical command that impressed orchestras so greatly. His actual hearing astonished them.
Plis en ampli, his plis en ampli. And the very first chord, I don't know if you know that score, this enormous score that needs about three tables to hold it. And the first thing is this massive chord. And he just went, oh, no, 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 second horn, F natural. And picked out from this fortissimo chord of 190 instruments smashing away, his ear was acute enough to pick that up.
For many decades, Boulez was constantly revising Plis selon Plis, his tribute to the poetry of Stéphane Mallarmé. Composition in progress, he said. And reconsideration was his approach to everything, not only that he composed, but also that he conducted. And it had been in 1976 that Pierre Boulez had conducted his first ring cycle at the Shrine of Wagner, the Bayreuth Festspielhaus. And for the liner notes of the recording of the ring cycle that he conducted there in 1979 and 1980, he himself wrote, "The ring demands variety of expression, often involving exceptional agility, brilliance, and clarity. The myth of Wagner's story..."